गुड इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, सो होप यू हैव डन विद व्हाट वी हैव डन इन द प्रीवियस सेशन. आई टोल्ड यू दैट टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू इंट्रोड्यूस मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स टू यू. सो हेयर इज द बायफरकेशन इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू ऑल. 40 मार्क्स इंडियन इकोनॉमी एंड देन 40 मार्क्स मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स. टोटल थ्योरी पेपर इज 80 मार्क्स. सो वी हैव डन two chapters of Indian economy till now, and today I am going to introduce macroeconomics to you. Okay, so just let me wait for another minute before proceeding. Let others also to join, then I am going to start with macroeconomic concept today. Fine. Okay students, now just have a look what is there in macroeconomics. So what we are going to study. So in 11th standard you were introduced to microeconomics. Hope you all remember what was there in microeconomics. So first let me just differentiate between macroeconomics and microeconomics. Under microeconomics you all have studied about theory of demand, theory of supply, fine. Then you studied about the market price. So there you were talking about a single variable, single unit. That means you were talking about a consumer or a producer. But macroeconomics is a wider concept. Here we will talk about the whole economy. Like we will talk about the GDP, unemployment, poverty, inflation. So these are the problems or these are the economic issues that cover up in the whole economy. So if I talk about the inflation, that there is 5% rate of inflation in our economy. Inflation means rise in the price level. So if I'm talking about the rise in the price level, I'm talking about the whole economy. So that will be a macro variable. So we will study macroeconomics in detail under the macroeconomic book. Okay, fine. So what is there in the macroeconomics? I am going to start with money and banking unit. I am going to introduce this to you, and this is the second unit as per CBSE curriculum. So this is the CBSE curriculum that I have highlighted. So whatever is there in the CBSE curriculum, we need to cover up these concepts only. So you can have a look on this CBSE curriculum. Under money, we need to know about meaning and supply of money. Then we need about the currency held by the public. So this thing we are going to cover up. So what is money? Do you have any idea about what is money? Did you hear this word? All of us are aware of what is money, fine. All of us need money. So now we are going to think about the whole economy. That means I am talking about the Indian economy. And in India, we know that there is circulation of money. What is the circulation of money? What is which currency we are using? That is rupee, fine. So we are going to discuss this money, that is rupee, in our economy, how is it printed and how is it supplied to the public, fine. So this measures we will understand under the concept money. But we need to understand that before introduction of money, barter system was there in our economy, when goods were exchanged for goods, fine. In earlier time, what we used to do, if a farmer was in need of shoes, he needs to give rice to someone which he is growing, and then find out the shoes from where he can avail, and then they used to return, exchange that. That was the barter economy, fine. But there were certain drawbacks in the barter economy, as it was very difficult to find out the other person who will be ready to exchange goods with you, fine. So that's why the need of money arise, that we can easily do some trade when required, or whenever transaction exchange is required, without finding out the person in return who is in need of our product. We need to get some unit which should be acceptable to all, fine. So we all know about this history, that previously what was their coins. First of all, coins came into existence. Then if I talk about the current system, current monetary system, what are there? Coins are there and paper currency is there. We all are aware of that, fine. So what is money? Why money came? Due to the problems that were faced under the barter economy. So here is few more reasons that why barter economy was not successful, because there was also a trading cost. What is trading cost? In case you need to exchange your goods through barter economy, you need to find out the other person who will prefer your good and give the good which you like to have. So that was the search cost. Then this utility of waiting, unless you are able to search the person who is ready to exchange with you, you need to wait, and waiting always give us some sort of dissatisfaction. So these were the drawbacks. So we will see what are the problems that were faced under barter economy and how money came into existence and sorted out those issues. So first was lack of double coincidence of wants. Double coincidence want means that if I want to exchange good with other person should also need my good, fine. He is ready to exchange with me. So that is the coincidence of want. So money sorted out this problem. Money acted as a medium of exchange, and you can easily exchange goods with the help of money. Then it was very difficult under the barter economy that to find the, rice was to be exchanged with shoes, what is the price of rice? How to determine that, fine? And how many quantity of rice should be exchanged for one pair of shoes? So how to determine that? That was the problem in the barter economy. But money again sorted out this problem. How? Money acted as a unit of value, fine? And also, lack of standard of deferred payment. What does this mean? If you want to make some payment in future, for example, if you borrowed one cattle from somewhere in the barter economy, then how to return that, fine? So that was again the problem. But money you can easily refer for the future payments. You can just return after some time. Then difficulty in storing wealth. Under barter economy, there was some perishable goods also which you can't store, fine. So, but money can be easily stored out. You can store the money very easily, very conveniently. So these were the problems that were faced under barter economy, and money sorted out these issues. But detail of barter economy is not in CBSC syllabus. So only these things are sufficient, more than sufficient, to understand about barter economy, fine. So now we talk about money in two sense. Money is in narrow sense. If I talk about money, is something which acts as a medium of exchange. That means it helps to sort out the issue of exchanging your goods. If you want to buy something, you just give that person money and get that thing buy purchased. Okay. So that is the narrow concept of money. But if I talk about the broad concept, fine. Under the broad concept, what is this? Money is something which acts as a medium of exchange, which you can even store as a wealth, and even which you can make in future payments also with the help of money. So that is the broader sense of money, fine. So this two classification of money are there. One is the narrow sense and another one is the broad sense. So Indian monetary system, I already told you that it includes paper currency. Rupee is our currency, and then coins also are included under the Indian monetary system. So now come to the money supply. Now I just think about the economy. I am talking about the Indian economy. If I talk about that, what is the money supply in our economy? So that means what I am talking about, I am talking about the money held by the public. That means how much money is in circulation, how much money people are having, fine. So that is the money supply, how much money is held by the public at a particular point of time. So we can categorize money supply as a two components. One is currency held by the public, and second one is net demand deposits held with commercial bank. What is this net demand deposit? You need to understand that. See, if you have some income or you are earning something, one thing is that you can retain cash in your hand, fine. So other thing is you can deposit that money in the banks, fine. And but you can get that money from bank on demand whenever you need. So that are demand deposits. And why I referred here net demand deposits? Because banks are holding some money of other banks also, fine. I don't want to include that in the money supply. Money supply includes only the money of people, that is the public money, fine, not the other bank's money. So it includes the currency held by the public and the currency that the public has deposited into the banks. So that is the money supply. So under this concepts, three marker question can be there, that what do you understand by money supply. So you need to just bifurcate, just remember this formula, that money supply equals to C plus DD, fine. See, earlier there were four components of money supply, M1, M2, M3, M4, but these all are not in the syllabus now, in the CBSE, okay. So now we need to go through only one component, one form of money supply, that is money supply includes currency held by the public, fine, plus
in my school my teacher said that my barter system is also not in syllabus, ma'am, is that true?
Yes, barter system is also not in the syllabus. That's why I have showed you this curriculum also, that we need to do only these things in detail. This is the CBSE curriculum pick I have taken for you all. See, it clearly shows you that you need to understand money meaning and supply of money. That supply of money, they have told you that currency held by the public and net demand deposits. So only one definition of money supply you need to learn, fine. Other M2, M3, M4 now that are not in the syllabus. So don't waste your energy over there, fine. So
okay, ma'am.
Barter economy is also not there, but you should have a little understanding of the barter economy. That's why I introduced that to you, okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Fine. So, what I was discussing with you, I was discussing this money supply with you, money supply, currency and the net demand deposit. So this component should be clear to you. Only in this chapter, these three questions can be there. No other question can be there. This is actually money and supply includes two chapters. One is the introduction of money, and under introduction of money, only these three questions are covered. Nothing else is there. So you need to understand this three question, and then money part of money and banking would be over, and the banking part is little wider, or you can say vast, which we need to spend time. Okay. So, define money. Can you define money? Anyone? In narrow sense and in broader sense, two definitions of money we have done. So, what is that money? I have told you here. I'm just going back where you get the idea of money. In the narrow sense, money is something which acts as a medium of exchange, only medium of exchange. But in the broad sense, money is something which acts as a medium of exchange, common unit of value or store value, or also as standard of deferred payment, future payments, right? So you can refer this definition as per the marks. If one marker is there, you can refer only the narrow or broad sense. While if three marker is there, you need to cover both the point. But most probably one marker question will be there from defined money, right? So then the states, the components of money supply. What are the two components of money supply? Can anyone answer? What are the two components of money supply? I told money supply means how much money is in circulation, right? That means currency. Now you need to make your thought process active, proactive, in order to understand this macro concept. So I am talking about the money supply. So just think what I am talking about. I am talking about that how much money is there in the economy. So what does money supply mean? Money held by the public, and public hold the money in the form of currency, that is rupees, or they deposit their money with the bank. Only two options are there. So these two components are included under money supply, right? Net demand deposits, and another one is currency. So you need to remember. So why I am referring net demand deposit, that thing also you should keep in your mind, that net demand deposits I am only including because banks hold deposits of public as well as other banks also. So I don't want to include under money supply other bank deposit. I want to include only the deposits of public. So that's why I am writing the word net demand deposit. So you need to understand this, fine? And in case defined money supply, explain its component, that is same second question. But here three marker question is there. So what do you need to do? You need to elaborate that currency held by public and net demand deposits. That's all. Excuse me. So this was the first part of the money and banking unit. You need to cover only these three questions and this portion will be done. Now come to the sixth chapter in your book and the other part, that is the banking part. Now you need to understand this banking very clearly. What is there in the banking? I think you all have heard the word banks many times, and you have even listed also banks for some reason, fine, maybe with your parents if you don't have your own work relating to the any banks. So now I am going to discuss about the banking system also. What are they doing? Okay, their functions also we are going to discuss. So first of all, in order to understand the banking, what we are supposed to understand, just have a look on this picture and what idea you get. What if you go to bank, why you go to bank? What is the purpose of going to bank? Did any one of you ever visited any bank? Just give me answer.
Yes, ma'am.
Achha, Malika, why did you go to bank? What was the
ma'am? Ma'am, because I wanted to have a credit card, that's why.
Okay, fine. So, see, now the purpose of going, there are many purposes for which you visit to any bank. If you need to take loan, you go to bank. If you want to take car loan, personal loan, many types of loans are there, fine. Or if you want to deposit your money in a safer hand, you go to bank and deposit your money, fine. So, mainly now, first of all, I am going to study, make you aware about the commercial banks. Okay? Then we will come to the central bank. So two we need to do in detail. So what about the commercial banks? Commercial bank, they have majorly these two major activities. First is accepting deposit and second one is advancing loan. So whatever surplus fund are there with you, you can go and deposit with the banks. For that, you are going to earn interest, fine. And second purpose is advancing loan. So if in case you are need of some loans, you can go to bank, approach bank, and if you fulfill their criteria, you can avail the loans from them, right? So now what are the commercial banks? They accept deposits from the public and they grant loans to the people only. Okay, now what is the difference? How when they accept the deposit, they pay interest to the public, right? And when anyone takes loan from the banks, then what is done in that case? They are supposed to pay the interest. So but the interest that the banks pay is less than what the bank charge. Okay, you need to understand this. Thus understand this, what you need to understand, that you deposit amount in the banks, fine. When you will deposit money in your bank, what will you get in return? In return, you are going to get interest, fine. Now what bank is going to do with that amount? For example, 10,000 you deposited. Now bank will further give loan of that amount to some other person, fine, some other who is in need of money. So bank will give that person loan, fine. So this way bank is going to earn profit out of that, fine. This we will just bifurcate further in the next slide. So just understand that the commercial bank, their purpose is to earn profits. So now there are two types of deposits that are there in the banks, commercial bank. First is demand deposits, and that second is fixed deposit. What does fixed deposits mean? When you deposit money for a certain longer period, like 5 years or 7 years, fine, that are the fixed deposits. You cannot withdraw the money before that. But other option is demand deposit. This is that anytime you can go to bank and demand your money back, and that will be given to you. Okay, so that is the difference, that demand deposits, you can deposit in the form of demand deposits, or you can deposit the money in the form of fixed deposit. So just tell me which you will prefer. See, if you want to do saving for a longer period, you can have a FD, because you are going to earn more on this FD. Bank give you more rate of return, that is more interest on FDs. And if you don't have any option or willingness to earn or to save money for a longer period, then you can have a demand deposit. And mostly the business class have the demand deposit, because they are in need of money for day-to-day purposes. So what they do, they deposit their extra money in the bank, and when they are in need of money, they just withdraw that money. But the interest that is given by bank on this demand deposit is very less. So you need to understand that difference in order to understand the functioning of this commercial bank. So now we will come to the functioning of commercial bank also, because you are clear with the two types of deposits, that are demand deposits and fixed deposits. And you understood the difference also, that what are demand deposits and what are fixed deposits. And one more difference is there, that you get the check facilities in the case of demand deposit. I think most of you have seen the checkbook and you are aware what is check. If you you can withdraw the money through check also from bank. So checkbook is given in the case of demand deposit, not in the case of FDs, fixed deposits. Okay, so that is the difference. So now we need to understand that this is the main function of commercial bank, credit creation. They are creator of money. They are creating the money. So how do they create the money? That you need to understand. So for that, you need to remember, just tell me what was the main function of commercial bank. What I told, two functions you need to keep in mind. Do you remember, Mallika, what are the two functions of commercial
bank? Yes, ma'am.
What are those?
Ma'am, they accept deposits and they advance loans with the aim of earning profit.
Okay, very good. So what they do, they accept deposits, whose deposits? Public deposits, who are having surplus fund, and they give loans to the one who need loan money, fine. So what is the purpose behind that? To earn profit. That means they will charge high rate of interest to the one to whom they are giving the loan, and pay less amount on the deposits, fine. So this way the difference will be their profits and they are going to earn out of that. So now how they are going to earn out of that, how they create credit, that we are going to understand through this process of credit creation. So this is very important, and mostly in the board exam they ask you this credit creation process in 3 marker or 4 marker. So but unless you will understand this process, you will not able to write. So just try to understand this what I am going to explain you. See, I am just telling you that in economics, in 11th also, if you have done with the microeconomics, you would be aware that we all the theories are based on certain assumptions. Then only the theories are developed. For the process of this credit creation also, these assumptions are there that should be kept into mind. Then only you will able to understand the whole process. So what does this assumption say? That whatever, for example, if I am a shopkeeper, so if I am going to sell my goods in the market, so whatever money I will receive, I will immediately go in the bank and deposit that, fine. So that is the one assumption, that all the revenue whichever will be received will be deposited with the bank as a demand deposit, fine. So and what other assumption you need to remember, that all the transactions are carried through banks and single banking system is there, okay. So this two assumption you should keep in the mind to understand this credit creation. And you need to understand this term legal reserve ratio. What are these legal reserve ratio? See, Bitta, when we deposit money in the bank, for example, you deposit 10,000 rupees in the bank, what the bank is going to do? Bank is going to give loan out of that. That we know. See, but the bank cannot give loan of entire 10,000 rupees. Why? Because anytime that person can come and ask, demand for the money. So the bank need to keep certain amount in the reserve, fine. And how much amount should be kept in the reserve, that entirely depend on LRR, that is legal reserve ratio. So under legal reserve ratio, two terms are there, SLR and CRR. So bank need to keep certain amount as reserve. For example, if 10,000 money anyone has deposited, bank will keep 2,000 in reserve, on 8,000 bank will lend to the other party, those who come to the bank for loan, right? So now this 2,000 which is kept in the reserve, that can be in two form, either in cash form or in the liquid asset. Cash form means cash, you understand, currency. So cash reserve ratio is when the reserve is kept in the form of cash, and SLR is when the reserve is kept in the form of liquid asset. Liquid asset means like shares, which can be easily converted into cash by selling in the market, right? So this way bank need to keep in the reserve. Why? For the safety sake, that in case anyone come for getting back the money, bank should be in position to return that money. So in the this credit creation process, you should understand this legal reserve ratio, and under legal reserve ratio, CRR and SLR. I have explained both the terms to you in a very simple words. Okay? Now understand the process of credit creation. I told that what how the credit creation process starts when anyone goes in the bank and deposit money, fine. So from there the process starts. Now see, someone came and deposited, for example, A is the person who came to bank and deposited rupees 1,000. Now what the bank will do, since LRR ratio is 20%, this I have just posed, I am taking some example or some illustration to explain you the process. So if the 1,000 rupees is deposited by A in the bank, what the bank will keep 20% as reserve. 20% means bank will keep 200, that is 20% of 1,000 as a reserve, and give 800 loan to the other person, right? This only I told you how the process begins. So just have a look on this slide. This is the first round. That means whatever is deposited by this A, that are the primary deposits that the bank is getting at the first level. Okay. So what is this? 1000 is the initial deposits and LLR is 20%. So just fill up this. This means bank will keep how much as cash and give remaining as loan. Anyone? If deposits are 1000 and LLR is
200 as cash.
How much? Okay, 200 as cash reserve. Very good. And how much loan will be
given? 800.
How much?
800 will be given. 800.
Yes, 800 will be given as a loan. Okay. Just if you have any doubt.
Okay, ma'am.
If you have any doubt in this step, let me know. Because unless this step is clear to you, you will not able to cope up with the next step. Just let me know. Okay. So I am assuming this is clear to you. So the initial deposits are 1000 rupees, fine, and 20% is LR. So bank will keep 200 as reserve and remaining 800 will be given as loan. So this is the first round. Now see, when 800 is given loan to another party, fine, whoever the loan is given, what that person will do? That person will just spend wherever he want to spend the money, fine. And when he will spend the money in the economy, whose ever income or revenue it would be. See, for example, I am spending money and I am buying something from Mallika. Mallika, that will be your income. My spending will be your income. Similarly, when that person who has been given loan, he will spend that money, then that will be the income of the other person. So what that other person will be doing? He will come to the bank and deposit again that 800 rupees with the bank. Fine. This is the second round. So now 800 again deposits bank receive. So what bank will do now further? Bank will again keep 20% as an LLR and that is the reserve. Fine. And grant loan for the further amount. Fine. So this 800 become revenue for some seller who deposit this money in their bank deposits. So bank get new deposits of rupees 800 who again keep rupees this much as reserve. How much? 160 rupees will be the reserve and remaining 640 will be given as the loan. Fine. So beta, you can understand this through this table very clearly. So just have a look that initially 1000 was deposited as amount and how much LLR? 20% was the LLR. So reserve will be 200 and 800 will be given loan. And when 800 will be spent by that person, then that will be again the deposit in the bank. Fine. Now again, what will be there? 20% will be given for reserve and see 20% reserve and then 640 will be the given as a loan. Now, when the 640 will be given the loan to the other party, he will again spend that money. And when that will be the income of the third party, that will be deposited in the bank, 640, fine. Now, so bank will continue this process. And how long bank will continue this process? Till the total deposits are 5,000. Why 5,000? That you need to understand through this relationship between multiplier and LLR. Why bank will create total 5,000 deposits, fine. So see, multiplier equals to 1 upon LLR, fine. What is multiplier? That is 1 upon LLR. Okay, so just have a look here. Multiplier equals to 1 upon LLR. So what does this mean? How many times this amount will be increased? For example, see what example we have taken over there. We have taken initial deposit was 1000 rupees and LLR was 20%. This we have taken the example in the previous slide. How I have started, fine. So just have a look. What is the multiplier? Multiplier is 1 upon LLR. So what is LLR? That is 20%. So money multiplier amount will be 5. So that means money will increase how many times? 5 times. Initial deposit was 1000 rupees. So it will increase 5 times. That will be 5000. So just have a look. Total deposit is always equals to multiplier into initial deposits. And so what is multiplier value? 5. And what is initial deposit? 1000. So total money, that or total deposit that will be created will be 5000 rupees. So this way we will stop at 5000 rupees. Mallika, hope this is clear to you, or shall I repeat this process?
Ma'am, can you read?
Yes, because this step, this process requires little understanding. So I'm just repeating this process. So just have a look again. I told, just first you need to understand that when anyone deposit money in the bank, so what happens when, for example, if I went and deposited 10,000 rupees in the bank, so what bank is going to do? Bank is going to grant loan out of that money, but the bank cannot give loan of complete amount. Bank need to keep certain amount as reserve. So how much reserve bank has to keep, that depends on the LLR. So if LLR is 20%, that means I have deposited 10,000. So LLR is 20%. So 20% bank will keep 2,000 in reserve and 8,000 loan bank will give to you because you went to bank to give take the loan, right? So now what you did, you have taken the loan. Now why you have taken the loan? Because you were in need of money. So wherever you were in need of money, you will spend your money over there, right? You will spend that 8,000 rupees in the economy. Now, when you will spend that money, that means that will be the income of other person. And I told in this theory or in this process, you need to make that assumption. What assumption you need to make? That whosoever income is there, that person will come and deposit the money in the bank. So you have given 8,000 to whoever, fine. जिसको भी आपने दिया वो 8,000 आके बैंक में डिपॉजिट कर देगा, फाइन। अब जब उसने बैंक में डिपॉजिट कर दिया वो अमाउंट, सो फिर बैंक के पास डिपॉजिट्स आ गए। अब बैंक क्या करेगा? बैंक अगेन 20% उसमें से रिजर्व रखेगा और फिर थर्ड पर्सन को लोन दे देगा। तो ये प्रोसेस विल मूव ऑन टिल टोटल डिपॉजिट्स मल्टीप्लायर के अकॉर्डिंगली नहीं बन जाए। तो हाउ टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस, जस्ट हैव अ लुक ऑन दिस प्रोसेस। That initially 1000 rupees were deposited in the bank. So 20% is the LLR. So what the bank did? Bank has kept 200 as reserve and 800 was given as a loan by bank. So now when bank has given you 800, what did you do? You spent that income in the market, and to whomever you have given that money, that person will come and deposit the money in the bank. Okay. When he deposited that money in the bank, now bank again received 800 rupees, fine. These are the deposits with the bank that bank has received. So now what the bank is going to do? Bank is going to follow the same process. What process? Bank will keep 20%, that is 800 into 20%. What is that amount? 160. 160 as reserve and 640 bank will give loan to the other party, fine. Whoever came, for example, A came to the bank for the loan. So bank will give 640 as the loan. When A received the loan, now what A will do? A will again spend the money wherever he want to spend. So when A will spend the money in the market or in the economy, what that person will do on receiving the income? Then again, he will come and deposit that money in the bank, fine. So this process, when 640 will be deposited, bank will follow the same procedure. Whenever bank will get any deposit, bank is going to keep 20% as reserve and rest of the amount bank will give as a loan. So same process, 20% of 640, 128 will be reserved, and less, next will be given as a loan to the other party. And when the loan will be given, then again that amount will be there. So this process will go on till the total deposits are, see the total at the end, 5,000. Now how this 5,000 amount has arrived, that totally depend upon the relationship between multiplier and LLR. So what is the relationship between multiplier and LLR? There is the reserve relationship. See, from the money multiplier name, it's clear that how many times money will be multiplied. That means if the initial deposits are 1,000 times, how many times that will be multiplied, that refers to the money multiplier. So, and that totally depend upon LLR. What is the LLR? 20%, you remember we have taken LLR 20%. So initial deposits was 1,000. Same example I am carrying forward. And LLR is equals to 20%. So if LLR equals to 20%, so what will be the money multiplier? That will be 1 upon LLR. So what does that mean? 1 upon 20%. That equals to 5. So that means whatever deposit the bank will get at the first step, bank is going to multiply that 5 times and create total deposit. So this 1,000 was the initial deposit, and when bank will multiply it 5 times, bank is going to get 5,000 rupees as a total deposit. So this way this process is created by the bank. Mallika, is that clear or still any doubt?
Yes ma'am, it's clear.
It's clear. So you need to understand when it will come for four marker, what you need to just remember, you need to remember only this table, how it is working, and you need to derive this relationship. And when you will able to derive this relationship, then easily you can get 3 mark after get explaining this relationship and this table. That's all.
Okay.
Now just I am going through the things which we have done so that any point is unclear, you can just clear out that, okay? So we have started with the money. What is money? Why the need of money arrived. So due to the drawbacks or the limitation of the barter economy, we felt the need of money. This we have done over here. Then what was the problem in the barter economy? Search cost and disutility of waiting. These were certain issues with the barter economy. So due to that, the need for money arises, right? So then we have defined money in two sense. In narrow sense, I am talking money as only as a medium of exchange. While in the broad sense, what is money? Money act as a medium of exchange, value, store value, and even as a standard of deferred payment. So these are the various functions that are covered for money. See, in your book also, there would be a very vast description of money. These functions are elaborated in detail. So that all are not in the syllabus. You need to understand only the meaning of money in such a manner that it can come for one marker, and you need to define that. That's all, okay? So now, Indian monetary system, we know that paper currency and coins are included under this Indian monetary system. And what does money supply mean? Money supply, we understand that how much money is there with the public in the economy. So that is the money supply. So money supply have two components. One is currency held by public, and another one is demand deposits, net demand deposit. That is the deposits with the bank, that public deposit, that you deposit, that I deposit, okay? That on demand, I can get back from the bank. So this all are included under the money supply. So these are the two components of money supply. So you need to do this under fifth chapter. Then under banking, I just explained you about the functions of commercial banks. So if we talk about the functions of commercial banks, there are two principal functions. One is accepting deposits and another one is advancing loan. So what does this banks do? Bank accept deposit and then bank give the loans to the other purpose, other person. And the what is the basic idea or basic reason behind that? It is the only profit motive. So that we have done, earning profit. So two types of deposits are there. One is demand deposits, another one is fixed deposits. And I hope difference is clear to you. What is demand deposits and what are fixed deposits? Okay, for 5 to 6 years or 3 years, you are depositing money. That is the fixed deposit. And when you get demand any time with the bank just to return the money, that are demand deposits. So then I made you understand this process of credit creation. Fine. So hope this process is clear to you and you are clear with the CRR and SLR. Malika, did you get the difference between CRR and SLR? What is the difference between the two terms? Malika, are you explaining the difference?
Ma'am, actually my net is not very good, ma'am. Actually your voice is breaking.
Okay, fine. So I was asking the difference between CRR and SLR. CRR means when you keep a percentage in the form of a cash, fine? Reserves in the form of cash. And when you keep the reserve in the form of liquid asset that can be easily converted into cash, then that is SLR. So that is the difference. And combination of CRR and SLR is LRR, okay? So that is the difference.
Yes.
Okay, then under this process, Malika, just go through this process and if any round or any point is not clear, I will elaborate that process again. The steps are clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. So today I'm just going to explain till this money creation only. And in the next session, we will begin with the central bank's function, okay? Now, because under commercial banks, we cover only the money creation. This is only in the syllabus. I told the curriculum also. So this you need to just go through again. And in case you have doubt, you can ask me in the next session. Fine?
Ma'am, which book, ma'am, we should refer for class 12 macroeconomics?
Which book you are using right now? Just let me know. See, I will just refer you to TR Jain is the good book. You can carry forward that book. But their power booster in TR Jain book that are of certain high level. So first you go through the syllabus, fine. Then cover up those power boosters. Even Sandeep Garg book is also good. But TR Jain is also good.
Okay,
good book. I like that.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay? Just follow that book. Yes, that so, okay, I'm just ending up this session now.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, Vita.